In this video, I'm mainly going to be focusing on the anatomy of the neuromuscular junction, but I will also be giving kind of a broad overview of the physiology. However, if this is very new to you, I suggest you just try to take in the general gist of the physiology while more focusing on the names of things and how structures are related to each other. And then when you're ready, you can check the description for related videos on this topic that are going to be more focusing on the physiology. So what we're seeing here is the whole muscle. And then inside that whole muscle, we have these many individual bundles. And I've pulled out one of them so we can look at it a little bit more closely. That is a fascicle. And what a fascicle is a layer of connective tissue called the paramecium, and that layer of connective tissue is surrounding a group of muscle cells. So all of those little bundles in the fascicle, those are the muscle cells. Then over here is a section of our spinal cord. Coming out of our spinal cord, we have our motor neuron, and then this is the axon of the motor neuron. So where that axon is meeting the muscle cell is the neuromuscular junction. So what's going to happen is an action potential is going to sweep down this motor neuron. If you don't know what an action potential is, you can just think of it like an electrical impulse. And then once that action potential reaches the neuromuscular junction, it's going to trigger a release of chemicals. And then that release of chemicals is going to cause a new action potential to sweep down the muscle cell, and that is ultimately what is going to make the muscle cell contract. But take note, this motor neuron is not just going to one muscle cell. Every motor neuron goes to multiple muscle cells, so therefore every motor neuron has multiple neuromuscular junctions. So when we have an action potential that comes down the motor neuron, it's not just going to make one single muscle cell contract. It is going to make every muscle cell that it is attached to contract. So those group of muscle cells are going to contract as a unit, which we refer to as the motor unit. So here I've only drawn two different connections, but in reality, even the smallest motor units would have at least five muscle cells, and you would find very small motor units like that in very small muscles that are moving very small things, like perhaps muscles moving your eyeball. But they could also be very large. A motor unit could be thousands of muscle cells, like the muscles in your thighs. So if this motor neuron was going to your thighs, when that action potential came down, it would make thousands of muscle cells contract. All right, so now that we're kind of clear on where the neuromuscular junction is and its broad functioning, we're going to look at this one single neuromuscular junction a little bit more closely. So the neuromuscular junction is a type of a synapse. If you've heard of a synapse before, you might have heard about it in relation to connections in your brain, a neuron-to-neuron connection. But this nerve-to-muscle connection is also a synapse. And it is going to have three main parts. So the very end of the neuron is called the axon terminal. Then on the muscle side of things, we have the cell membrane of the muscle cell, which the cell membrane of the muscle cell is also called the sarcolemma, but the sarcolemma here, specifically at the neuromuscular junction, is also called the motor end plate. It can also be called the postsynaptic membrane because if you think about the direction of the message is coming from the neuron to the muscle, and that's why this would be postsynaptic. Then the space in between the axon and motor end plate is the synaptic cleft. So those are the three main parts. And now we're going to look at some of the important structures on those parts. So the axon terminal has two main important things. There are voltage-gated calcium channels, and there are synaptic vesicles filled with acetylcholine. So just to be clear, what we're seeing here is the end of the neuron has been cut open so that we can kind of look inside of it. This voltage-gated calcium channel, like all channels, is a passage through the cell membrane, and it is called voltage-gated because it's not always open. It's like a doorway. Sometimes it's closed, in which case it is not going to let calcium through it. It is called voltage-gated because what opens it is a change in the charge of the cell membrane. Another way to say that is it is going to open due to a change in membrane potential. So there are lots of things that can change the membrane potential, but in this specific case, the only thing that should be opening this voltage-gated channel would be an action potential, because an action potential is causing the charge of the cell membrane to change as it passes over the cell membrane. Then the synaptic vesicles filled with acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is a chemical, it is a neurotransmitter. A neurotransmitter is any chemical that is being released by a nerve for the purposes of communicating either with a muscle or another nerve. Other examples of neurotransmitters would be dopamine, serotonin, but acetylcholine is the only neurotransmitter that is found at the neuromuscular junction. And synaptic vesicle. A vesicle is just a sac, so literally this is just a little sac of acetylcholine. On the motor end plate, you can see we have other channels, but these are not voltage-gated channels. These are called ligand-gated channels. Ligand-gated channels are a type of chemically gated channel. So ligand-gated means specifically it's either going to be a neurotransmitter or a hormone that opens the channel. In this case, the neurotransmitter, acetylcholine, is going to bind to this channel to make it open. And then in the synaptic cleft, we have acetylcholinesterase. Whenever you see ACE at the end of the word, it is an enzyme. And in this case, this is an enzyme that is going to break down acetylcholine. So broad picture overview of what's going to happen here is we're going to have an action potential sweep down the cell membrane of the neuron that is going to cause these voltage-gated calcium channels to open, which is going to allow calcium to rush into the cell simply because there's more calcium on the outside than the inside. So when you open the gates, the calcium rushes in. The calcium rushing in is going to sort of push the acetylcholine out into the synaptic cleft. And once it's in the synaptic cleft, it is going to bind to these ligand-gated channels, and that is going to allow sodium and potassium to cross over the membrane. And those charged particles crossing over the membrane is what is going to trigger a new action potential to spread down the muscle cell. The job of acetylcholinesterase is to break down the acetylcholine and clear it from the synaptic cleft to end that process. So these are kind of the main terms that I covered. So I would first make sure you can kind of define these terms and know what these things are. And then I think you can start to worry about the actual details of the physiology. As I mentioned, I do have other videos relating to this topic, and you can check the description to find them. I hope this was helpful. Have a great day, and have fun learning.